Hello, everybody. I must tell you that I am very pleased to be here today in front of you, and also very glad that so many people are interested in power management. That's cool. So again, my name is Patrick Tissionneau. I am a system power management expert. I spent the last 9 years at TI doing power management stuff, from architecture to system integration and system power management optimization. Today, after TI, I have decided with colleagues to co-found the Belibre company, consultancy and training company specialized in Linux embedded technology, because we believe we can share all the knowledge we got through all these years at TI to other people and other markets. The topic today will be use case power management optimization, identifying and tracking key power indicators. This is the discussion I propose you today. And for that, I would start with the problem. What's the problem exactly with power management? Why is it so important? It is important because the wireless embedded platforms, their performances, they keep increasing a lot. Every year, there is a new device with more CPU cores, more megahertz. We have crossed the 2 gigahertz barrier. There are hardware accelerators, high-speed memories, high-speed peripheral buses. So all this keeps increasing. But at the same time, your power budget and your thermal budget for your final product is still the same. If we consider a mobile phone, we are still in the area of 5 watt power budget for the full platform. The temperature of the case cannot exceed 45 degrees, otherwise it will burn your skin. And still we need to have your phone at least running for a day. And today we know how difficult it is. So in the end, what does it say is that, well, we have more and more pressure on the power management side to make this happen. So here is, we will describe a methodology to try to take care of this. So. I propose the following menu for you, if you wish. As a starter, you will have a description of what we consider being the key performance indicators, or KPIs. Then we will describe a methodology. We will give some practical examples and some thermal management consideration, because thermal is also tightly linked to power management. And finally, some thoughts and recommendations. So let's go with the first part, the description of what we consider being the critical KPIs. So what we call KPIs, or key power indicators, that's statistics that are profiling the activities on your platform and that are relevant to power management. So in other words, that's any info you can extract from the platform that will help you understand why your power consumption is good or wrong, identify the some root causes and fix it. Probably the most obvious ones, the running clocks and power resources. So obviously, the big thing about power management, the thing you need to, I mean, the number one priority is to only use what is needed to run this scenario. But everything that is extra, that is not used, and hardware accelerators you don't need, it has to be off. So the first thing to do is to identify all these power resources, from clocks to power switches and voltage regulators, DPLs, etc. You list it one by one, and then you check that it has to be on or not. And then if not, you fix it, obviously. So this is very important, because this is somehow at the start of everything. This will define all this power that is wasted for all the time of all the duration of the use case. It's some sort of baseline, and that everything else is built on top of that. If you manage to have this the lowest possible, then it's a big gain. Then we have also to monitor the C states, or idle states statistics. So the idle states is all the low power states the CPU can be put in. It's not actually only the CPU on embedded platforms, but more also the peripherals. So this is handled by the CPU idle framework automatically, I would say, as far as it is enabled. And so this is all the states, low power states, that the CPU can get in. And there are multiple ones, from the simple, the most simple one, which is only gating some stuff. It has a minimum latency, but also a minimum saving. There is almost no gain in this one. And then you go to the maximum where you put almost everything off. But then you have a penalty in terms of sleep and wake-up latencies. So you have to use the statistics exported by the CPU idle framework to understand if your CPU is behaving as expected. If you go into the expected low power states, and if you stay long enough in these states. On a similar thing, the operating point statistics. So we have described the low power states. Now, when the CPU is doing some processing, it may be of different levels. And so there are now OPPs, or it's different operating points where you have different running frequencies and running supplied voltage. And here, again, you have to monitor this. You have to know how much time the CPU spent in each OPP, how many transitions there were, so that you know, again, if this is as your expectation or not. This is also a good indicator when you have thermal issues, because if you monitor the statistics and you see that the highest OPPs are not being entered, then potentially this is because of thermal management throttling that is preventing the highest OPP to be entered. Going deeper into the dynamic part of the processing, the load is something also very important to monitor. But not only the CPU, also all the other accelerators, any processing unit typically on the platform should be monitored. It's not always available, but it's still something needed. Because this is also explaining, by monitoring the load and the running processes, you may identify which processes or services are consuming, generating a lot of processing, and so preventing the CPU to sleep. Because ultimately, for power management expert, the more the CPU sleeps, the better it is. This is very helpful because you can identify, sometimes on the UI there are some lags, the frame rate is not the one we want. Maybe this is because the CPU is busy processing something else. The memory bandwidth is also an important item. We usually only talk about CPU load, but actually I would call it the memory load is also very important, because sometimes the bottleneck is not the CPU processing performance, but the memory performance. The CPU can actually run at very, very high speed, but still the memory cannot answer so quickly. So sometimes actually the CPU is just busy waiting for the memory to get the data. So it is important to check that the bus load is not too high or is as expected, and that the latencies are also low. The next item to monitor, the next KPI, are the MPU interrupts. This is giving a very good picture of the peripheral activities over time. You know that these interrupts, this is all the asynchronous events that will interrupt the MPU from its regular processing to do this very short but still important activities. And depending on the rate and the number and the rate of interrupts, this may be an issue for power management, because if the rate is too high, your CPU will be interrupted all the time, and the idle policy will not decide to go into a low power state, because it knows the CPU will wake up immediately. So this is very important to check that. And this is also important because potentially there is an issue with one of the peripheral driver, and this driver keeps generating interrupts to the MPU, and this is causing a performance and a power issue. On the same page as the interrupts, the software timers are also as important. Again, they keep waking up the CPU all the time, so preventing idle states to be entered, the lowest one. So this is why you have probably seen in the kernel some tentative to synchronize the timers whenever possible. This is to reduce the number of wake-ups and maximize the idle time. Finally, the last item I would describe you are the temperatures. This is something very important because actually the power consumption for the same job just explodes with temperature. It's exponential. So doing the same job may consume twice or four times more if it's done with a high temperature. So it's very important to keep it low all the time. And this is also a good explanation when you measure consumption, it's higher than it should be, what you have estimated, and maybe it's just because of the temperature. The processing is good, the configuration is good, but the temperature is higher. Okay, so that was a quick description of the KPI. I hope you didn't lose the pass. Now I'm going to propose you a methodology to do a use case optimization. Just to make sure the definition of a use case is clear, what we consider a use case is all the interaction in your platform to accomplish a goal. Well, you may have thought that the optimization starts with measurements, but actually no. It starts much earlier in the development phase of your platform. It starts at the definition of the platform. Because to be able to optimize something, you need some target. There is no point optimizing when you don't know when to start. Maybe you're good, actually. So you need a target. And to have a target, you need estimations. And those estimations, they are based on power modeling. So when you define a new platform, you will also create some sort of power model of this platform, and you will describe how your use case is being done. So all the processing that is required, all the necessary hardware blocks that are required, you will put this into your power model, and it will generate you some estimation of what should be the power consumption for this use case. And that will become your power target. And later on, when you will have the software and the silicon and you will take the measurements, the goal will be to get as close as those targets. So once you have defined your target, you have to put things in place to measure and to be sure to compare to the measurements to targets. So I call this instrumentation. And this is not only about instrumenting the software, but it's also about instrumenting the hardware. So obviously you have all the lab equipment to take measurements, but you also need to make sure that when the PCB of the platform is being designed, there are sense resistors put in the right place to take at the same time current and voltage measurements. You have the right temperature sensors in the right places. And ultimately, the state of the art would be to have hardware trace in the silicon and some embedded power measurements capabilities in the power companionship. Because then this is the only way to close the loop. I will discuss this a little later. Next step is to automate. So you have put all the stuff in place in your software, in your platform, to do measurements and track indicators. Then you must really automate all this, because this is really a long, annoying, approximate and source of error task. Without automation, you cannot compare apples to apples. The currents, the voltage and the power, this is analog parameters. So if you take twice the same measurements, it will not be exactly the same. We are not in the digital world. So, which means that for taking a measurement, it's not actually taking a single measurement, but it's taking multiple ones, averaging it to make sure it's good. So, I would give two very funny examples, but this is actually the reality. Measuring a boot time with a swatch is not good. Okay, there is no precision, no accuracy, it's not good and it's boring. Second example is taking tons of measurements of different rails for different use cases. Or again, you do the measurements on your lab equipment and you report by hand in your report the measurements. That's just nonsense. Okay, so we are close to the measurements now, but still not. You finally got your silicon, and you have some software running on it. The next step is to characterize the raw performances of your silicon, which means that there has been some assumptions taken during the definition phase of the platform about how much the silicon will consume when it's idle, when it's in retention state, when it is active. And now you have to make sure that these assumptions are good. So in this case, you will run some very basic software like Drystone, GLBench for to load the GPU, measure the I/O consumption, et cetera, et cetera. All this is to make sure your power model was accurate. And so the next step is exactly to assess the power model. There is no point trying to reach a target that is wrong. Maybe too high, maybe too low. If it is too high, you have not actually optimized your platform. It is too low, it is not achievable, and it will be consuming time and resources for nothing. So in this step, you have to converge with this raw characteristics of your platform. You need to converge it with the model. And so in the end, you know you have some level of trust in your targets. Yes?
What do you mean by raw silicon?
For instance, it's the leakage of a silicon. So you know the silicon is not perfect, and even if it's doing nothing, there will be some leakage current going through the chip, and so you will have some consumption. So even when it's off, it consumes.
You take your board, and without running high-level software,
yes. Yes, 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 it is, yes, yes, yes. For instance, if I take a concrete example about the CPU characterization, you will have either some very, without any OS, some bare silicon software that will put the silicon in all the low power states it can be in and make sure it is aligned with the estimations. And then after, you will load the CPU with Drystone or some other benchmark stuff, and you will also again make sure that the consumption is increasing as expected.
There's a lot of work to
do. Yes. Yes, there is. But you don't need to. So the performance of the silicon is the same for all the logic of the silicon. So doing the thing on the CPU is enough. So it's almost enough. You have done almost all the job.
Of course, because even though the 11th clock is non-rocked by the
peripheral. Yeah. Yes, here it's not at all about use case, it's just to assess the power model. So usually the hardware people, they are coming back to you with some power characteristics of the silicon. They will tell you, okay, in this state it will consume that much current. With that level of processing and that voltage, it will consume that much power. And here the job is to make sure this is right. Okay? No problem. And then finally, you got it. You can start doing measurements of the use cases. So here, very simple, it's all automated, if you did the job good before. And so you just have to make sure the measurements, you take multiple measurements and you make sure this is in the same ballpark. If there is a lot of variation from one measurement to another, there is a problem either on the setup or on the definition of the use case itself, because it is not reproducible. And don't forget to collect all the statistics that we mentioned before for further analysis. So 99% of the time, when you do the measurement, it's not aligned with the targets. In the early phase of the development. So this is time for analysis. So as I said earlier, you have a static part called leakage of the consumption and a dynamic one. You have to start with the static one, because this will be your baseline consumption, and this is the first one to optimize. So this includes supply voltage, I/O configuration, making sure there is no misconfigured I/O, or unused, unnecessary pull-ups, etc., etc. All these parameters here, you have to check that it is set as expected. So once the leakage is under control, then you switch and chase for extra processing or bottlenecks, performance bottlenecks on your platform. So here we are talking about the CPU, the GPU, and all other hardware accelerators which are generating some consumption based on the processing load. So here this is about making sure the supplied voltage are the expected ones. You have to check the timers, the interrupts, the sleep durations, etc., etc., and again make sure it is aligned with what was described in your power target and power model. Don't forget to also check the consumption of the bus and the SDRAM. It is a big contributor to power consumption, and so you have to make sure it is also in range. Last step is to analyze also the temperature. As I explained, it is a critical item, and so you have to check that the temperatures are in range. And now it is time for fix, but not only the code potentially, but also the power model. Doing all this analysis, you will find that your description of the use case was not fully accurate, that it is not possible to generate exactly this use case. You may have some background other services running that was not part of the estimation. So this step is an iteration process between you, software system engineer, the architect that designed the platform and produced the power targets, and the developers to decide who's right, who's wrong. And also don't forget to set an acceptable limit. It is not possible to achieve the power targets because this is the best case. So you have to define a limit like, okay, if I am getting close 5% to the target, then I'm done. But actually you're not done, because you must not let power diverge again. There will be, along the development cycle of the product, there will be no new software releases, and so potentially new patches that may hurt the power and degrade it again. So this means that these measurements, they have to be taken again and again for each new release. And you have to be strong. That was a big and tough task in my job previously. Power is not yet in most companies as high priority as performances and features. So usually the power is the last wheel of the car, and this is very difficult to say. I don't want to dispatch to go in because it's hurting power. You really have to be strong. But again, this task, if automation was put in place, is not a big problem. Because the potential divergence will be automatically highlighted for you by the tools. Okay, so that was a lot of descriptions. I would like to provide you a concrete example of an analysis. So for this example, I will use a tool that I developed while I was at TI for OMAP processors to automate the capture and the processing of all these indicators. So this application is called OMAPConf, and it's publicly available to everyone. So the idea is that in one single line of command line, I could get the info I needed without any extra processing from myself. Sometimes I get a little lazy, so I want a tool to do it for me. So here the use case I propose you to show is a single 3D Life wallpaper, the Android water. So that's the leaves floating on water. It was run on a Panda platform, OMAP 4 platform, running Android 4.2.2 release. So here I will present you the reports that this tool is able to generate automatically. I will not really get into details about the values itself because I don't believe this is the purpose. Really the idea is to show you how automation is great. So this tool is able, so if you run this command, omapconf audit and the name of the use case, it will monitor all these indicators, power indicators, and will give you a pass-fail final status about all the parameters, whether they were as expected or not. So here in this on this first slide, you have different parameters displayed. You have the CPU freight governor that was running during the audit, all the voltages, the OPPs, and the clock speeds. And so you have what was measured, what was expected, and the final status. So just in one glance, you know exactly what's good, what's wrong. And clearly, you can already rush into this item to understand why it's not like this. So you see you have all the fails status, and so if there is a fail status shown here, then it means this is an item that has to be optimized, that is not aligned with the estimation. If we continue down to into the report, there are some other hardware parameters, the C states, so the CPU low power states. It's going to check which ones were entered, the lowest one actually, and making sure it is aligned, all the clocks, etc., etc. So here again, you can see that the DSP was not in the expected state, the GPU also, and some ABDPL was not stopped as expected. At the end of the report, there is a pass rate data being displayed. This is very useful, as I said, for tracking, because those data, you could take it and save it for each new release, and you could have, you know, along the development cycle, you could see how it could evolve. Some other details that the tool could extract, that for each single clock of the platform, it could tell if the rate of this clock was good or bad. So here, very quickly, you have the pass-fail. Some other dynamic performance parameters were not shown before, and there is another command line that is used to that. Here, it's gonna show you more dynamic parameters and some statistics about it. So the first one is showing you which C states, so which CPU low power states were entered, how many times, and how much time the CPU stayed into this state. Again, this is very easy to check with the estimations. Same thing for the OPP. You have exactly the time spent in each OPP and how many OPP transition occurred during the duration of the audit. So here, what could be strange is that for such low performance use case, the lowest C state of the CPU were not entered. So maybe there is something preventing this to be entered, maybe a constraint set by the user. And also, you could see that you still, even if there is almost nothing to do on the MPU side, it's still spending quite a lot of time in the highest OPP. So there is a problem. More info again. So here, this is about the interrupts. Looking at all the interrupts that has occurred during the use case is very useful. Because you could extract different kind of information. First, you can check that there is no extra interrupt being fired. And here, clearly, there are. The wireless, the WL is the wireless link, so this is the Wi-Fi chip of the platform. It's generating some interrupt. The MMC as well, you wouldn't expect it. And it is also very useful to check the rate. If you look at the SGX ISR, so this is the GPU interrupt. You see this is it is firing at 120 interrupt per second. Actually, this is twice the frame rate, so 60. So it's also a very easy way to check that the frame rate is right. And so finally, the last thing I wanted to show you in this example is that we have seen some sort of report about what happened, but we couldn't really see it. So here, there is also a possibility to export a trace, to capture a trace of all these parameters over time and to show it into a chart. So here, again, a report about those parameters, the CPU load, the GPU frequency, the temperatures, but I prefer to show you that, which is actually some GNU plot scripts automatically generated by the tool, and it will represent you So the speed of the processors, the load, as well as the memory load, and the temperature. So if you observe that in this area, you would see that there is some extra processing, I mean, more processing than everywhere else. And you can also identify it looking at the CPU and OPP, because you see you spend more time at the highest one. And finally, you can see that it has an immediate impact on the temperature. So the duration is very short. You see it's 2 seconds, but still you manage to raise the temperature by 2 or 3 degrees. So that was the analysis. And how to conclude? I would not conclude, but give some final thoughts or recommendations about all of this. First advice would be to anticipate. It is too late to fix power issues when you face it. If you haven't done all the things we described before, then it is too late, because there will be no infrastructure on your platform, on your hardware or software to extract this data and understand what's happening. So this is very important to anticipate. Then think twice when you are designing your new silicon and partition it for power. You have to have power in mind. You must not build a house with a single power switch. So which means that each peripheral shall have its dedicated clock switch, that you should group as much as possible the peripherals per use case under the same power switch, so it's very efficient. Do not share scaling voltage regulators, scalable voltage regulators, sorry, because it's inefficient. And use as much as possible retention techniques with low latencies so that the CPU can sleep the more possible. Because one thing to know is that the voltage is the key of the problem. This is not the frequency. The frequency is not the problem, because the power is actually proportional to the square of the voltage. So scaling down the frequency without scaling down the voltage is a waste of time, and it will in the end consume more power, because your CPU will remain active longer. Fine-tune the policies. All the CPU freak and CPU idle policies that comes by default with Linux are actually not targeting embedded platforms. They are more targeting desktops and servers. So they may work fine for some situation, but not for all situation. And actually, there is not yet a perfect policy that is good for all. So don't hesitate to switch policies on the fly during use case detection, and fine-tune the parameters based on your platform. And finally, keep cool. So it is easier to waste less power than find mechanical solutions to dissipate more power. We are in the embedded world. We are not in the desktop PC world. So we have no fan. We just have a case and your skin to dissipate the temperature. Keeping the temperature down is also important, because it's a good way to avoid the problem of user interface degradation. If you start scaling down the CPU frequency because you are warming up too much, then potentially the platform will become less responsive, and so the user will see it, and that's not good usually. And finally, my last recommendation is that the only thing that really matters is the battery. You don't care about optimizing to the maximum each single power rail you have. The only thing that matters is the battery. So you have to focus on the main contributors to this consumption. There is no point saving 30% of power on a rail that only accounts for a couple of percentage of the total consumption. You won't see it. And also, don't forget that you are handling a very complex system. So things are all interdependent. Maybe you do some optimization on one end, but on the other end, it is actually increasing the power, because maybe you slow down a processor on one side, but which means that it will run for longer. So maybe in the end, the consumption will be higher. So that's very important to think system. It's not all about the CPU, it's not all about the GPU, it's about the full platform. And that's the end, and I will thank you for having followed this session, and I hope you find it interesting. It's now open for questions. Yes?
Did you find the problems with this screen saver?
Yes, well, we found some, okay? We have identified some root causes. We haven't, this one, I did this only for this presentation, okay? It is no more my job to do that. But clearly, you have a lot of information from this analysis. You have a lot of information of hints. Okay, I have to check the CPU processing because clearly it's very high. There is a lot of OPP transition. Maybe my policy, the CPU freak policy that is running, is oscillating or is too sensitive, and so it keeps putting the CPU high wherever there is no need. Things like this. So this tool is very tools like this are very helpful to help you highlight the problems. It's not going to fix you the problems, but it will highlight you the problems. And so then after, you can go back to your code and see what's the problem. Another question?
Your Theramo comp tool,
yes,
only works with OMA 4, or can be maybe adapted to other TI
platforms? It is. This tool is publicly available, so for sure it was in the first place targeting the OMAP platform, so it's running on OMAP 4, OMAP 5, and now TI is doing some porting on the Citara platform. Some functions are clearly hardware specific, because this tool is able to go directly pick up the information into the registers of the CPU, so there is this is not generic, but some other functions like this trace, etc., some parameters like CPU load. It's generic. So part of the tool is actually generic. One of my goals is to update this to have a tool that is more generic than OMAPConf. Yes.
It's maintained by TI.
Yes, TI is still maintaining it, but it's available on GitHub, and so. Yes.
Thank you.
Another question? Okay. Well, thank you very much.